Shoot. Here's the thing. I just got this car running again last year. Yeah, 2021, right? I bought this car either in 2006 or 2007, right? For 14 years, 14, maybe 12. For 12 years, this car did not run. It didn't even move. It sat in a field in North Carolina. Apparently, when my brother, like, it was in North Carolina. I had the military ship me over to Utah. The military shipped me to Japan. I came back. I was in Utah doing some stuff. My brother was like, hey, I can bring you your other car from North Carolina, right? North Carolina to Utah. It's a bit of a drive, right? He drug this car onto a flatbed trailer and then brought it to me in Utah. And for an additional several years, it just sat in my garage. I did fit some new tires on it because the tires were flat and everything like that. But it was not working at all, right? In fact, here, hold on. Again, this is going to be one of those things. For those that have not ever seen these pictures, let me show you guys what the gas tank looked like when I started to work on it early last year. So the gas tank, where are you? Okay, so yeah, the gas tank, when I pulled the fuel tank out, this is what the gas tank looked like. It was nasty. Just completely full of gunk. Just complete nastiness. Okay? After I started scraping it out, getting a lot of crap out of it, that's what it looked like after I started scraping the big, nasty, varnished fuel out of it. Okay? It was still nasty, right? So then, I ended up filling the thing with vinegar. Put vinegar into it. I also put a whole bunch of nut and bolts, right? And over the course of a week, I would let it soak in different sides, right? And I would also shake it around, and the nuts and bolts would wear on the gunk on the inside. And in fact, here's another picture here. That's what the mice and rodents had done to the spark plug wires, as an example. So those all got changed out. And then, after changing out the vinegar multiple times, changing out those nuts and bolts, this is what the fuel tank ended up looking like. So I had the entire fuel tank cleaned out, right? After this, I filled it up with isopropyl alcohol, right? And had it, sloshed it around, got all the vinegar out of it. I also ran a vinegar solution using a sacrificial fuel pump to pump it around through the lines going back and forth. I probably ran those for about 8 hours, cleaning out all that crap to get the fuel system all completely cleaned. But yeah, after that, where is it? Changed out the fuel pump. Fuel pump was also nasty as hell. And then I bought a can of, what do you even call it? It is a fuel tank sealer. It's this red stuff, and you take it, you put it into the fuel tank, and you just slowly turn the fuel tank every angle, and it just coats everything on the inside. So that gave me a nice sealed fuel tank. It was also a corrosion control to keep any exposed, like, those nuts and bolts running around in there, it probably scratched the paint on the interior of the tank a little bit. So I put a new coating of that sealant all over everything inside. Went in there with a brush and tried to get the little, the baffles and everything. Just did that. Let it set for a week with one of these barrel fans, like, circulating air through it and everything like that. And then, yeah, just put it back in the car, and that's what we've been running. So, now in the future, we might end up, like, I mean, that's the story on what's happened with the car, right? Notice how we haven't even started working on the car yet. We're just talking about random stuff, right? My goal with this vehicle is I want to take this thing completely apart. Every single nut and bolt off of this vehicle, every single nut and bolt that I have are going to go into the bead blaster that I have over there, the sand blaster. Clean all that stuff off. I'll probably anodize all of them. I know the general process of getting the stuff and making the solution and dunking it in there. We're going to do that with all the hardware. We're going to make it all nice. We're going to completely take the motor apart. We're going to be doing some modifications to the motor to try to make some more power. Then everything's going to go back together. And yeah, but we're going to take this entire car apart at some point. However, here's where the catch is. Right now, at this moment, I need this vehicle to run because we got to work on the Miata and get some stuff done with it. Once the Miata is back up and fully running, it will become the runner, and then we can start taking this one apart. Yeah. So, yeah. Again, the stuff with the Miata, I got to change the timing belt. Right now, I have to take the radiator out. The radiator has a crack, okay? There's a small tab on the side of it that mounts the radiator to the body, and that tab over time has bent like a paperclip, and it's cracked, right? So I got to take this radiator to a local shop. They're going to weld that bit back on. But because I have this giant radiator out of the car, I'm going to take that time to do the timing belt on the vehicle. What the hell is that? Okay. We're going to do the timing belt while the radiator's out. While I have it out, let me see if I can try to explain this now, too. Okay, so this cable right now does not have enough length to reach over there. Now, where the RX-7 is sitting right now is going to be where we film everything. So these cars are going to be swapped locations when I work on the Miata. So let me explain what we're going to do here. In the front, you have the chassis rail that comes right up through here, okay? You have another chassis rail that comes up right up through here, okay? The structure that is between those two chassis rails, okay, does absolutely nothing on the vehicle, okay? This little bit on the top, it's thin sheet metal, stamped, so it's got a little bit of strength because of the shape, but the only thing this rail does is it holds the hood latch. That's it, okay? However, down below, there's another big chunk of metal, which is the metal bumper that makes up the front of the car, okay? That's the structure that is supposed to take a hit, right? What we are going to be doing is that bumper section in the front, the area that is between the two rails, we're cutting that completely out, okay? The reason why is that bumper support is actually a huge air obstruction for the radiator. Okay. Again, it does absolutely nothing for the structure. But just to tie two rails together, that is why I have this. Okay. So this is going to bolt at the bumper level to tie the front of the two rails together. Right? So this will be underneath the bumper. You will never see this. I'll probably paint it gloss black just to match everything. But that will replace the big, thick part of the bumper that is just doing nothing but obstructing airflow. So that's another thing that we're going to be doing. So get to pull out the cutoff wheel and cut a big chunk out of my car. Joy, right? And then again, I've got some brake pads that we got to change out. Other than that, I think the only other stuff that I have is, oh, that's what fell over my light. Get that off of the car. The only other stuff that we can possibly do to the Miata is I can unbolt the roll cage and change out the driver's side seatbelt. The driver's side seatbelt does have a couple frayed areas on it. There's like a little centimeter long fray on one part of it, and I bought new seatbelts for it years ago, but the problem is that the roll cage is in the way to getting them, so I have to remove roll cage to get access to them. So we could do that too, but again, projects. Other than that, I'm trying to think, is there any other major stuff with this car that I need to do? And then, yeah, the suspension fixing, so the car has better ride, what is it called? Yeah, more travel for the rear suspension. That's what it was. Okay, so now I have to locate my number 10 wrench, 13. Where is my number 10? Oh yeah, here's, this is gonna be one of those things of I've lost my damn number 10. Replace my seat with one of the chairs from the Rosinante. They pump me full of juice and do high G maneuver. I wish, Lance. However, I don't think my car pulls that many G's. Oh, here's the number 10 sitting on the. Yeah. Now, I do want to change out the seats in the RX-7. Also, Realoy Spankin's four-rotor project perhaps. I wish, dude. I wish. But the problem is if I wanted... Oh, crap. I think I just turned something off. Turn that back on. Okay. The problem is... What's the condition of the metal under the paint? There is... You know how the side of the car and the bottom of the car usually come to that little piece of stamped metal? There is some surface rust on it, and I think the biggest damage is the previous owners put a jack underneath it, and that piece of welded-together metal got folded over. So there is a little bit of rust on that, but it's surface rust, right? Other than that, yeah, it's just surface rust on a lot of, the suspension arms are aluminum, right? So, by putting them into the bead blasting that surface off, I do plan on, like, this car, when it's done, is going to be white. The entire vehicle is going to be white. The suspension, entirely white. The brake disc calipers, I think I'm going to go with a white and blue theme on this vehicle. When I paint the irons are going to be painted a really, really dark blue. But then everything else is going to be white. I want white because, again, aviation mechanic, right? I want white for ease of inspection. That's my main thing. So yeah, the entire suspension is going to be painted white. There's like no rust damage on this car at all. Now the paint looks like crap, okay? But that's because the previous owners did like a really shitty paint job, and it sat in a North Carolina field for like 8 years before it got back to me. So paint it white except the lower part of the car, do like a panda paint job. except the black part painted as if it were the space shuttle TPS tiles. That'd be an interesting paint job, Lance, yeah. But no, I mean, if anything, what I might end up doing is using that... if I do to this car what I want to do, I want to put the chassis on a rotisserie, right? So I can completely spin the car upside down and get everything on the bottom cleaned out, you know? What I would like to do is, if I can get it onto a rotisserie, I'm noticing some corrosion in the engine bay where the pipes are attached. I think you're seeing more... Okay, so hold on. If you're talking about, like, the pipes, yeah, the pipes are a little bit rusted, but the actual chassis, no, that's all, like, dirt. If I clean that off, like, that's, like, completely undamaged paint underneath that. I can hear Malcolm in the other room. He's loud.
What's up, buddy?
Okay, so I have to watch him. What's up? You can come over and help me? Don't go outside. Don't go outside. You gonna help me out here? Okay. If one does play 2D non-VR games on virtual desktop using Oculus Rift, does a PC need to be powerful enough to render for each lens? Yes. I mean, you are still technically rendering a VR view at that point. But virtual desktop is a lot easier than, say, a pure VR game. Because a VR game is trying to render a 3D view in the entire thing, while the VR desktop is just rendering, like, a virtual screen. And sorry, guys, I'm having to watch him and make sure he doesn't go after the birds, because my neighbor has bird feeders, and... Yeah. Are you trying to get on in the trunk? Okay, so, here we are. We are only an hour and a half into the stream. And finally, we're going to actually do something to the car. Fun, fun, fun. All right, so here we go. There's the thing on the bottom. Lefty loosey, righty tighty. Got to remember it's reverse because of... I'm upside down. Okay, one is loosened. Let's unplug this one wire. Okay, that is up and out of the way. Move that one down and out of the way. All right, so yeah, here I've got a line that has a lot of electrical stuff into it. So I got to get around that. So that's going to snake through there. Reach around that. Where are you? There you are. Okay. So again, lefty loosey, righty tighty. I'm able to get a whole eighth of a turn every time. There we go. Just gotta get to the point where I can unscrew it by hand. Did you guys hear that? Like I said, like, after his fall,
He has been extremely loud.
And Kazen, what's up, dude? How you doing today? Kazen, don't know if you checked the Star Trek section on the Discord today. I posted a link that went to a little Twitter thing talking about them building the D-Enterprise model for the show. That'd be something you might like. Okay. So, there's the first little nut. I'll set it off to the side here. Get the other one. Okay, so there's the second one. Okay, and there we go. So there's our piece. You can see the two little indents where the O-rings will go. And then when you look down there, kind of, sort of, can't see it because the shadow's exactly on it, you can see the O-rings that are there, and they are so old, they are completely stuck on. And they're completely flattened. They're supposed to be O-rings. They're not supposed to be a flattened ring. So they are just completely mangled. And oh no, I tore my glove. Oh no. Now my fingers are going to get dirty. All right, so what I'm going to do here is I need to find my scribe. And while I'm doing this, change out the one glove. Tell you guys, having these gloves on so you don't have to wash your hands of all the nasty oil crap afterwards is so much nicer. Let me find another glove here. There we go. Bit of a chest infection, so quite tired. Well, dude, yeah, make sure you're like hydrating and stuff, man. That's my biggest problem too, is like whenever I do get sick, I'll sit there and I'll be like, God, I'm miserable. And then I realize, after being miserable for a couple hours, I should be drinking a lot more water right now. Okay, cool. I should probably, next time I order gloves, order one size larger, because these ones are a little bit snug. A little bit too snug. I think one size larger would be fine. All right, so now I have a scribe. I'm going to use this to pull those O-rings off. There's one. There's two. Cool. So, let's get a view of the O-ring real quick. So, it's supposed to be a circle profile. You can see how flat that thing's gotten. In fact, no, you can't. That thing was the original O-ring when the car was made. You see how flat it is. They're not supposed to be flat, and that is why they get all dried out and nasty. All right, cool. So there's those. And Charles Farmer, what's up, dude? How you doing today? Sorry, my glove is not fully on my thumb and ring finger, or not ring finger, pointer finger.
All right, there we go. That's better. All right. So there we've got that. Uh-oh.
Did Malcolm?
I think Malcolm went back inside. Yeah, I think he went back inside. Okay, cool. So now, let's go into the back of the car and locate. Where's my stuff? There they are. So I went to the store. And here's where, I don't know, like I bought these in case I need to try to use them. But I have a bunch of flat rubber washers, right? So if anything, I could try using that. I don't know. But I do have a bunch of O-rings here, too. So, let's get this thing all unpacked. I'd say that test garage stream success looks great. It was not like that when we started. We're still having issues every now and then. Like if the computer, like the computer was trying to disconnect and then reconnect, and then it got really, really stuttery. Again, we're still kind of figuring things out. I think once I get everything stabilized, and the other thing that I want to do is, like, the computer is not even in its final location either. So, yeah. All right, so now let's talk about this thing. So as you can see, here is the oil platform. You can see how the oil filter screws onto it. Let's actually unscrew this thing. Now, this oil filter is like 2 days old, so we are going to be reusing it. But you can see how that works, how the two holes go through it. One hole goes into the middle, the other one goes to the side, and that is how it passes the oil through the filter, one side to the other. So we are going to be reusing that oil filter because, again, it's only 2 days old. I changed the filter out first because I thought that it was the part that was leaking. And then discovered, no, it was not. And then that's why we're now replacing this part. All right, so what we're going to do now is we're going to modify this little piece, okay? You have to think, guys, when a car company makes parts, they make the parts quick and cheap, right? They might not be the best, right? It might have some, they get it to work. There's parts in it. There's parts in the motor that if they need to be precision, they are precision. But then there's other parts that, you know, close enough will do, right? This is one of those close enough parts. So what I'm doing here is I am getting as much oil off of this thing as possible. We will be cleaning this thing out multiple times before we put it back on the vehicle. But what we are doing is right here. Okay, so let me grab my scribe and explain what we're about to do. Okay, so if you look inside of this, okay, the oil comes in here, okay, goes through the port, and then the oil flows out through the filter, right? Right here, look at that hole. Look at all the sharp edges on that hole. And apparently the face cam does not like to focus, okay? But you see how this thing has all this sharp edging on the inside. Well, sharp edging is never good for, you know, you might have the oil like cavitate and stuff as it tries to flow past that. So again, one of those little modifications that I'm going to do here is I'm going to take my grinder and I'm just going to soften that edge just to make it so the oil pump's not having to fight the sharp edging of the flow. We're just going to round that over. So we're going to be doing a lot of little stuff like that. When we take this entire motor apart, we're going to be porting a lot of stuff on the intake, all that kind of stuff. So what we're going to do, or what I'm going to go do right now, is I'm going to go downstairs and I'm going to turn the air compressor on. I apologize, guys. Do you guys hear that? Time? One moment, guys. That's a little bit worrisome. Is it noon? I hope it's noon. Is it noon? Oh, God. A little bit of a freak out there. I apologize, guys. It is Saturday, exactly noon, and the tornado warning sirens just went off. That freaked me out for a moment. Usually, I'm downstairs playing a video game, and I don't hear them, right? They test them every Saturday at noon just to make sure they're working. Whew, that got my heartbeat going right there. Okay. So, hey, we know those work. God. All right, so what I'm about to do, I'm going to go down into my basement. I'm going to plug my air compressor in. Okay? Be aware, guys, it is probably going to be really, really loud. But I'm going to show you guys something else. Okay? Hey, buddy, you are in the house. Good. Yeah, so he went into the house, and apparently the wind had the door slammed. All right, guys, so at this point, if you're wearing headphones, take your headphones off. It is about to get loud. 3, 2, 1. Okay, cool. So now the air compressor is on. It's running in the basement now. And now I'm walking back into the garage. And we are back in the garage. You guys see why I put the air compressor in the basement? It's running right now. I can still hear it. So that's it. That is how loud the air compressor will be during the streams, right? Now I do want to, my goal is instead of having to manually go downstairs and plug the air compressor in, I want to have a remote button that turns a relay on downstairs, and I want to put the on-off button, one here in the garage, and then one just outside the door where the compressor is downstairs, so I can turn it on in two different locations without having to walk back and forth. Is that another compressor between the two cars? It was. It's a tank now. We talked about this earlier. That air compressor, if I can find the piece, the piston on the air compressor snapped in half. I'm just trying, yeah, there it is. Let me pull that back out and show you guys that. So for me to try to get this air compressor working again, I'd have to retrofit it with a different pump. Piston rod is completely broken in half. You can see at the top of the thing, you can see the piston's even mangled, so it's not fitting in the thing anymore. Yeah, ouch. That's not good. Yeah, it's completely broken. Because this piece is all together, and oh, I broke my glove. Oh no. That's why I have 5011 gloves. See, again, I think I got the gloves are one size too small. They work really good for keeping the oil off my hands, but they do want to rip a lot. But yeah, I think what I might end up doing is I think I might put a... what do you call it? I might... I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that, I'm going to cap the tank off, and then I'm going to put it also downstairs as just an extra tank, because I think the air compressor that I have downstairs is a 12-gallon tank. This is a 20-gallon tank. So I'm going to have that compressor downstairs fill both the tanks up, and then that way I just have a lot more air supply, so the thing, when it does run again, it won't, you know, hopefully it'll run less often, maybe. I don't know. We'll see. Again, down the road, I would like to have two air compressors all tied to each other so the pressure's shared between them, and that way they also share the cubic feet per minute airflow, so they don't have to work as hard together, because in the future, we're going to be doing a lot of stuff. Okay, so there's my gloves, and of course, I do that, and now I rip this glove. Can't win. All right, so, yeah. So what I'm going to do here now is I need to find my die grinder, which is right there. Okay, cool. So I have the die grinder. It's over there. Let me now look for my rotary files. Where are you? I'm an idiot. Guys, I apologize. I just noticed the air compressor is still running. It shouldn't be running that long. It's because I'm an idiot. Crap, 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 crap. Okay, note to self, make sure to close the drain valve before you start the air compressor. Let me try that again. Ah, crap. One moment, guys. Probably ran it for about twice as long as it was supposed to run. That's my fault. I really need to get one of those automatic drain valves, though. That way I don't have to do that either. That was my fault. Okay. So now the air compressor is running. I'm now listening, because it should get up to pressure relatively quick. Now that I actually, you know, remember to close the drain valve. All right, now I'm looking for where is my die grinder? Die grinder bit. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, you know how I was saying about I need to order different gloves in the future? I think I just found my... I did. Those are the large. The ones I've been using are medium. Let my hands dry out a little bit before using those then. So I do have large gloves. Nice. All right. Looking for my die grinder bits. Ooh, found my blowtorch. Nice. And there, the air compressor just turned off. Oh, found my 5-pound sledge. Nice. Okay, so I don't think the die grinder bits are in this box. Oh, I had them a little while ago, though. Where did I put them? We might end up just pulling out the Dremel and using its bits instead. I thought I had... Countersink. Where are my Dremel bits? Yeah, this is also one of the other problems, is just so much of my stuff is just still in storage boxes everywhere. So I'm still trying to locate it all. I remember seeing this thing yesterday. I remember seeing it. What did I do with it? A little case, and it had my really long bits. I thought I set it off to the side, but apparently not. There's my extra fuel line. Well, that sucks. That really sucks. I was hoping to... I want to port this thing and get it done with. I just have to do it the old-fashioned way and just use my files. I might use, you know, rotary file, but if I can't find them, I might be stuck using the regular file. I mean, it's aluminum, so it's not going to take long, but still... Power, you know? Wonder if there's a camera that can fill that fourth box that follows you around the room. Charles Fermer, I would like to do that. The problem is this. Right now, two of those cameras are face cameras. 1080p cameras that can run at 60 FPS, okay? However, both of those cameras... So, okay, this one is the normal... 30 FPS camera. The other two are, so that one right there and that one over there are the 60 FPS cameras, okay? You can see when I get in front of those, the motion on them are much, much smoother and faster, right? The problem is this. Those two cameras, it's a lot of data to send 1080p at 60 FPS. So those two cameras are actually running at 720p. If I set one of those cameras to 1080p, the entire stream starts chugging. So we are literally at the limit of my USB data flow or whatever the hell it is. So yeah, we're not, I can't go any higher with that, sadly. I wish, but not really a thing. So, we try to use a little bit of power with this. What I've got here is just my drill bit with a countersink. And what I'm going to use with this is you take it and at least round off the edge inside that bit. So, let's see here. So now, before I do anything else here... Where did I put my safety glasses? Great. All right, safety glasses, where are you? Nice. So I did find my little Dremel kit, so we can possibly use that one. Now the problem is, where did I put the Dremel? Oh, there, Dremel's right here. Sweet. So we can do that. Nice. All right, so there's the Dremel. Need to set up a GoFundMe for what? A GoFundMe for what part? Oh, router internet? No, it's literally, like, I mean, this is a brand new computer. But For me to get more cameras, I'd have to actually run more PCs in this room.
Actually, you know what? I could do that. Ooh. Hold on. Because I am using NDI, the way that I have my setup over here, in fact, here, look at this. This is my current setup, okay? So I have the computer that is running on this screen, right? But then I have my tuning laptop. Right now, my tuning laptop is only logged into Splashtop to control my streaming PC downstairs. That's it, right? I could technically run another copy of OBS on this with its own fourth camera, or hell, even the little camera that's built into the top here. Kind of hard to see there, but there's actually a little tiny camera right there. But I could run a couple more cameras on this, and do another camera that way. That is one of the great things about NDI. NDI is super nice with that. All right, so this is what I've got now. Okay, just my Dremel. Little snake bit just makes it a lot easier to work with this. What I'm going to do is we are going to steal the light power source. There we go. Plug in the Dremel. Make sure the Dremel's off. Low RPM. Don't want to plug it in and immediately have it ramp up to stratospheric speeds. Make sure it works. Cool. All right, so what I'm going to do now is we're keeping all our metal shavings away from the engine bay. So what I'm going to do now, let's see here. I've got myself a little milk crate here. Do I have another chair? I do not. I do not have a good chair. I have this. I have that chair, but that was... I bought that chair for a racing cockpit years ago. Yeah. Okay, so let's do this now. We're going to take the tripod. The tripod's going to get really short. And Kissing Jinx, what's up, dude? How you doing today? Got how to count? Yeah, there's probably a few. And I have the cameras going every which way. Leaving a lurk while watching Stargate? Nice. Okay, so here we go. We're going to go down really, really close to the ground. Cool. Now my problem is, where did I put my safety glasses? You do not want to be messing with metal shavings. You do not want to risk your eyes. Cool. So, found my safety glasses. Clean those off a little bit. Here's my little part. I almost forgot. I gotta go back into the house, grab a thing. Okay. All right, so I'm just gonna go into my dining room where I currently have my 3D printer set up, and I need to grab one of my bottles of alcohol. Yeah, the 91%, that one works good. So after we make a bunch of mess with the metal shavings, I want to be able to clean it all off, because you don't want metal shavings running through a motor. All right. Actually, no. Ooh, I just thought of something. We're going to go above and beyond today. I'm going to plug the air supply into the sandblaster. And I'm going to show you guys what we're going to end up doing to every single part on the car. So you guys can get an idea of what things will look like when it's finished. And Jacob Sy, thank you very much for the resub, dude. Appreciate that.
Where's the flux capacitor? I have... Not, see, car's not made of stainless steel, so flux capacitors don't work as well with this one. Maybe one day, if I ever make it doing the Twitch thing, maybe I'll have to buy a DeLorean and outfit it to do that kind of stuff. That'd be sweet. Okay, so, let's see here. I just sat down, and I forgot the part. Forgot the part. You need the part to be able to work on it. Okay. Let's see here. Let's get the camera all set up here. All right. So, paper towels. A little bit of alcohol. And this is just to get all the oil off of the part. Now, guys, do be aware, when I start grinding on this, I am going to turn the microphone off. That way it's not annoying you guys to hell and back. Do I have a tub to catch the shavings? That is what the floor is for. I have a broom afterwards. But we are plenty far away from the car. None of the metal shavings are going to get anywhere near the car. You can see I'm down here. The part that is open is about 2 meters away. And then I will be taking this part inside and rinsing it in my sink with water to get all the other metal shavings out. Okay? So again, so check this out. Okay? What we're about to do is this little hole right here. Again, see how that hole has a lot of really sharp edging on it, right? We're going to take that and we're going to port it and just make it smoother to allow the oil to flow into it a little bit nicer. That's all we're doing. And again, what it's just kind of an example of, this is the kind of detail that I'm going to be doing to my car when we take the full thing apart. Does that make sense? Okay, so okay, headphones on. Forgot another thing. Sorry. Oh, yeah, I'm not, like, with that, that's one of those deals of when I was in the Air Force, I have learned methods to, how do I explain this? You learn when you're working on aircraft on how not to trackle. To track FOD, foreign object debris or foreign object damage. You learn how not to track stuff around. So, yeah. Plus, before we do anything else, I do have compressed air here. That's the yellow hose you see on the ground. And I apologize too, I'm probably louder now. The air compressor, I do have an air blower that I'm going to blow myself off to. Okay, so at this point, I am turning the microphone off so you guys don't hear the whine of the electric motor. So it's going to be quiet. I am now changing out my bits. Let's see here. I think we might use that one right there. Turn this a little bit so I can see chat a little bit better. Forgot that turning that also turns the camera though, so. Okay, muting the microphone again. So, as you can kind of see, it's this little small thing, but all I did was just round off that edge to allow the fluid to flow smoother and not have to take a quick 90-degree turn. Does that kind of make sense? So just a little bit of porting, clean that up a little bit, and there we go. So, there we go. So now, what I'm going to do is go inside, run this underneath the water for a bit, and make sure we got all the little bits of dust particles completely out of it. Should also take out my earphones, because it's, again, it's one of those things. Protect your ears. You do not want to protect your hearing, protect your vision, safety glasses and earplugs. If you're doing something extremely loud, double hearing protection. All right, turn the light on in the kitchen. Let the water get a little bit warm because right now it is quite cold. Cold, cold, cold. Where is Malcolm? There we go. Decent temperature now. Yeah, this piece is relatively simple. It's not going to have a whole bunch of crevices for metal pieces to hide in. There we go. All right. Dry it off. Okay, and now, remember I told you guys I'm going to go above and beyond on this piece to show you what we're going to end up doing with the entire vehicle in the future. So, oh, there you are. What's up? He's sitting in the room next to the garage waiting on me to come back into the house. See, it's one of the annoying things. Like, if the door's open, got to be really careful with him getting out and about because he'll eat the birds. That's not a good thing. All right, so while I have this out, let me do a couple other things here while I'm thinking about it. Got a razor blade. I am going to use this to kind of clean up the surface. A little bit of residue from something on that. You want that, sir? Like, this is the surface that the oil filter comes down on. So you want that to be super, super clean. There's just some gunk on it. Okay, there's that. What about this side? That flat area too. The ceiling surface is actually this part inside where the O-ring seals up against it. Okay. There we go. So now, again, guys, remember I told you we're going to go above and beyond on this piece because I want to show you guys exactly what we're going to be doing to the entire car in the future. Also, did my chat, like, stop? Or is my thing broken? Do a quick test here. Test. Is that working? That is working. Good. Okay. Sorry, I'm just trying to make sure that the stream didn't, like, just stop out of nowhere. Okay, so now I need to find my blue painter's tape. Of course, I have also misplaced it too. All right, I gotta go search around the house. Where, like, I swear I've had like 8 rolls of this stuff. What's up, buddy? What's up? What's up? Give me a moment. I'll shut the garage door and then you can come back outside. You just really, really like to go after birds, and that's not good because my neighbor really likes his birds. All right, back in the basement. Where is my blue painter's tape? Huh. I swear, I do not know how I always misplace this stuff. There it is. Okay, never mind. There we go. Blue painter's tape. Awesome. Alright, so. Alright, buddy. You want to come back outside?
I need to get a magnet.
I need to set something up. I need to make a 3D print. We'll put a magnet. Shut both the garage doors.